You know, it's great to talk about like sort of what it is to talk to someone and be an interviewer. You were just sharing with me before we started that you got to interview Wim Wenders. So how did it feel to be in that position?
Oh my God, that was nerve-wracking. I worked on it. First of all, I did like a mini Wim Wenders film festival for myself because, of course, I'd seen some of his films, but not everything. So I watched everything and I was, you know, trying to model myself on people who I thought did really good interviews, and I had a big script and I had way too many questions because, of course, you just ask one or two things. But it was really touching because it was not long after Pina Bausch's death.
And I got to meet him then too, which was great when they did the screening in Montreal, and I knew the people who were doing the film festival, and we were just talking on a street corner, and he spent the whole time, the two of us spent the whole time talking and crying about Pina in the most beautiful way, you know. So
And I met Pina Bausch also because I got to present her with an award.
Oh, fantastic. Oh, during the event in Harbourfront?
Yes.
Yes, that was great.
And I got to dance also at that event. My unforgettable things was, you remember that stage, there were people seated on two sides. Yes. So when I came out to dance, I came out and stood at my spot where I was going to start, and there I was standing directly in front of Pina Bausch. I mean, she was 12 feet away or something, and we met eyes, and she gave me the most inviting, grounding, sort of compassionate look with her eyes. I felt like she said to me, "We have not met, but we know each other because we're dancers."
That's amazing.
Like she just,
I'm getting shivers.
Yeah,
that's amazing. She was certainly an icon. And I remember nominating her for that World Leaders event. I was working at Harbourfront at the time. Well, speaking of icons, there's my good segue. Every good interviewer has a good segue.
Well, I do have the same initials.
And you're here with us to talk about it, which is fantastic. I'm thrilled, Peggy Baker. Thank you for making the time to come in and talk to me today.
We're so happy to be here.
I know. We're so happy to have the Ottawa premiere of Who We Are in the Dark. You've been on this huge, fantastic tour, which I guess culminates in Ottawa this weekend, right?
Yes.
Right.
Yeah.
Been to lots of different cities and had lots of different responses. Ottawa is waiting for you. We're very excited. Of course, you have a long history here, and I'm going to talk about all that stuff. But we wanted to go back and talk about your incredible, rich history from growing up in Edmonton. Tell us about that cultural house. Was it a cultural house, or was dance something that came to you outside of your home?
Oh, well, we were all taking lessons.
Uh-huh.
You know?
Ballet?
No, tap. I was taking tap. Well, my mother taught tap dancing, actually.
That I didn't know.
So we all took tap dancing lessons, and I was also taking piano lessons, and I was singing in a choir, and I was taking art lessons on the weekends. So it was all about learning and play. I honestly, as a child, I don't think I quite got it that you could be an artist. I'm not sure, but we were for sure, we were making and doing. And so I always considered myself to know about dancing and to be involved in dancing, but it was, you know, it was one class a week in tap dancing.
Okay.
And then I was starting to do musical theater when I was in high school, and also dramatic theater, and I wanted to be an actor, and I got into the acting program at U of A.
Okay.
Which is a very...
Were you a triple threat? Like, could you sing too?
Well, yes, I could. I don't know how well I could. I'm not sure how threatening was, but, you know, I was triple, but I don't know if I was a threat. But it was really through my theater training that I discovered contemporary dance, because before that I thought dancing was tap dancing and musicals, or it was classical ballet. And I was really drawn to theater because of the range of possibilities for complicated female characters.
Uh-huh.
Like, I was very interested in what women could be in the world. And when I discovered contemporary dance, this kind of distilled theater and put women like on earth, I felt like, and in the present tense. Because I met Patricia Beatty at a theater school, and I had never met a woman like that.
And she came out to Alberta from Toronto?
She did. She had just left New York City. She had a company called the New Dance Group of Canada, I believe. And she was 32 years old because I was 16. And I remember thinking, oh, this is just so poetic because she's twice my age. And I'm just going to imagine I could be something like her when I'm 32. But, you know, she was a hippie.
Yes.
She had long hair down to her waist, and she was wearing earrings from Israel. And she was wearing no makeup, and she was wearing, you know, knit hipster bell-bottom pants that she was dancing in with a gorgeous leotard cut all the way down with an open back. And
oh my gosh.
Just like beautiful, sensual, actual woman.
You know, it's interesting because you and I both had an opportunity to see her just recently when she was honored at the Dance Collection Dolls Hall of Fame. And she still has that kind of energy, doesn't she, all these years later?
Oh, yeah. She's
one of the founders of Toronto Dance Theatre.
Earthy woman.
Incredible. So she turned your head.
Yes, she did. And I still thought, oh, I'm going to go to theater school and then I'm going to study dance and, you know, then I'll really be very... And then I realized during my first year of theater training, oh, I guess these people who are dancing like this, they've been doing it for a really long time and it's just a single-minded thing. So I dropped out of university and it was hard to leave that program because they only took 12 people into first year. You were basically an acting company.
Okay.
Bob Baker was in my class, who ended up becoming the director of Canadian Stage and later at the Citadel.
That's right.
There were many, many really, really strong theater people in that group and in that training. Although I'm super happy that I started with that training, actually. I knew how to run a dimmer board and I knew how to think about stage space and how to think about motive. And so really my motive when I started dancing was, I really want to do this and I want to do it really well. And I never lost that motive. Like I didn't ever forget. Everything you do, you're doing it to grow and deepen and expand. Like I was never going through the moves.
But you're really talking also about the passion and the drive that fed you to pursue this, even despite these sort of challenging circumstances to have to say to this group of people, I'm out of here and I'm making this move and moving away from Alberta for the first time.
Right. Yes.
So something, that drive.
Yes.
Is there?
Oh, I was very single-minded. It never crossed my mind that I might not succeed or anything like that.
So you arrive in Toronto, you're what, 19?
Yes.
And what was that like for you? My gosh, the Toronto scene when you're 19. What's that?
Oh, it was exciting. I'd never lived downtown. You know,
had
I grew
you been
up in
to
the
Toronto
suburbs of
before?
Edmonton. No.
No. So you arrive in Toronto.
I believe it was my first plane ride.
Okay.
Yeah.
Was your tap dancer mother very upset?
No, but I really miss my mother. Honestly, I have to say, like I grew up in a big family. I have 5 siblings and I didn't realize until I left home, wow, I am a child who's part of a family. Like I can say I missed my mother, which is crazy, but I did. She was a very grounding force for me and very compassionate, very patient person. But I was totally wrapped up in this new world. And
if you had to describe what the Toronto dance scene was like when you first arrived, what words would you choose to describe that?
Well, it was small. There was the National Ballet of Canada and there was Toronto Dance Theatre. And Judy Jarvis, I believe, she got back to Toronto from Europe sometime in the 70s, but really that was the professional scene where those two companies, York University Dance Department, started the same year that I moved to Toronto. But I had been catalyzed really by my encounter with Patricia Beatty, so I didn't think about going to York. I just was following my heart, basically. And so it was a burgeoning community because the National Ballet was experiencing a tremendous kind of success with Nureyev and Baryshnikov. Was in Toronto in 1974, I think. Like it was, and Toronto Dance Theatre was just really super exciting company. They had a huge following. They would do 2-week seasons, and people would come to see every show, and they would come to see, make sure that they saw each, you know, the dancers traded parts. And
so, just as a little perspective, it was a number of years later that I was at University of Waterloo in the dance program, not far from Toronto. And it was also a time when universities in Canada, bless this time, brought in dance companies to do performances.
Yes.
And that's when we first saw Dancemakers and Toronto Dance Theatre.
Yes.
Because those companies would come and perform in the Humanities Theatre or whatever.
Right, and York University was bringing the Cunningham Company and Paul Taylor. And it was not easy to get up to that campus, I can tell you. But people would leave downtown Toronto at like 5:30 in the afternoon. Do you get to an 8 o'clock show there? No, it was a really, really, it was an incredibly exciting time. And then, of course, people started coming out of York University, and dancers started coming out of the training with Toronto Dance Theatre, and that's how Dancemakers emerged in 1974.
Yeah. So what made you decide to actually form a company?
That was more of an invitation that I accepted. I was an apprentice with TDT in 1973. We came to the National Arts Center. We danced at Sadler's Wells. Crazy exciting. But I was already discovering a world of ideas about dance that were beyond Graham technique, because at the time Toronto Dance Theatre was absolutely devoted to that technique. And the dancers who were coming out of York University had a much more expansive kind of encounter with dance, and Andrea Smith and Nolan George and Carol Anderson were all coming out of that first graduating class, and Andrea wanted to do a concert, and she asked me if she would come downtown on the weekend. So she was taking like Saturday classes.
Okay.
TDT. So I knew her from that, and she asked, did I want to be in this concert? And I said, yes, of course, I'd love to. So we did a concert at, I think it was St. Paul's Church. And right after that, and she called the concert Dancemakers. And right after that, Andrea left for New York City. She ended up in the Louis Falco Company, which was a huge company at that time. And then eventually she ended up in the Graham Company. But she left this group of us that she had brought together for this show. And we all said, oh, let's do more of these. Right. So it emerged out of this impulse to do a performance, and then it was a group of people.
I think what's interesting, though, is that, you know, you talk about the sort of codification of technique around the Martha Graham technique at TDT and mm-hmm. the opening up of different techniques that were offered at York, but that's still talking about it from the performer point of view.
Yeah.
I think, you know, making dance and coming up with the ideas for what you're going to do is a whole other place. Was the concert the first time for you where you were experiencing other people making dance on you?
Maybe so. I mean,
it's different than a script, for example, in theater school, where you're given someone else's words to perform.
Yes, right? But you know what? At that time, most choreography, or this is my simplistic reading of it, the choreographers made up the steps, and you learned the steps, and you did the steps the way that they, the steps that they taught you, the way they asked you to do them, even though, and it was mostly happening in chronological order because it was mostly based on a piece of music. Mm-hmm. So in a way, it didn't feel that different than working with a script. Mm-hmm. It's just that you didn't know what was coming up. But it was very, it was a time in the dance world where dancers were, you followed directions and you followed instructions, and if you were making the thing, you felt that you needed to come up with all the instructions. And
so the challenge of making the thing, as you say, which I love, that challenge of making it, did you feel that that was just something that was your calling, even in those days?
Well,
because Dancemakers was known for that in the years that you were all a collective and these really powerful, strong women making your own work, making each other's work.
Yes, well, we were just learning and growing together. And I think we wanted to engage with our peers, and we wanted to engage with people who were more senior than us. And not only with people that were more senior than us. Mm-hmm. And this is why we wanted to do some things on our own. And it wasn't a grand plan for a company when it started. I mean, basically, it was people who were just had the energy and the drive to do some things. Toronto Dance Theatre was giving us free studio space at the end of the day after the evening classes finished. So we were working late at night, or we were getting some free time at York University. Like people were like, oh, this is fun. These young people want to do something.
Right. Young women. Yeah.
We got all women. Opportunities for youth grant.
Right.
You know, there were just a bunch of different things happening at the time. And it turned out to be, you know, a collective. And then it needed them. We had to have some kind of an organizational structure. But we were really a group of dancers that was organizing performance events, and we were also commissioning people who were coming, especially out of York University, who wanted to choreograph, or or members of Toronto Dance Theatre who were happy to experiment with these young dancers and have something, a work of theirs on one of our concerts. And it evolved into a company. But we were learning and growing together. And by the time, well, I went to New York for a year, 76, 77, I got a Canada Council grant. So this is only 2 years into Dancemakers, but I was just feeling like a tremendous need to get more training and to really just see more of the dance world, because there, as I say, there was not a huge amount in Toronto.
And New York was definitely the mecca at that time, for
yes.
sure.
So I went and I trained there for a year, and I came back. I was quite overwhelmed. I didn't ever think, oh, I want to dance in New York City. I was like, oh my God, that is like overwhelming. And I also felt like I would never be able to, I'd never find a place for myself there, but I was.
And yet.
Well, and yet later,
a few years
something
later,
did happen.
That's right. I mean, I remember you, and many people will speak of you as one of the most vibrant, charismatic dancers on the stage. This tall, gorgeous woman, completely overwhelming technically as well as from an expressive point of view. So the very well-known and important choreographer, Laura Lubovitch, from New York, is this how the story goes? Sees you and says, yes. Come back to New York, woman.
Yes, well, I took a workshop. I took two workshops. I was taking lots of workshops because these intensive courses were a great time to like train all day long from a specific point of view of a choreographer. And I had seen Lars work in New York City and I thought it was incredible. And one of the things that really drew me to it was he had a very interesting way of not necessarily discriminating between men and women. Like there was a lot of his work was quite, I want to say androgynous, or he kind of
gender neutral.
Gender neutral. And he also gave roles to men that were extremely lyrical and poetic, that were the kind of parts I was seeing, used to seeing women dance. And then he would also create these parts that were intensely kind of aggressive, physical, athletic parts for women. So for me, it was like, okay, because if you're coming from, I don't know, Graham, where it's very men, I mean, the training is all together, but honestly, when they go on stage, the men are dancing like this and they're dressed like this and the women
very
are
much
dressed like that and they're dancing like that. Or Paul Taylor or any of those big companies then, it was very, the men do this and the women do this. And it was very specific. And Lar was busting that open. I thought he was speaking about a world that I recognized that I wanted to be a part of, where the first thing about you wasn't, are you a male or a female, but like what kind of dancer are you and what kind of energies do you have? And
fascinating.
This is what how we really connected. And I did share parts with men in that company. I think I was the only woman to do so, but I do think this was kind of where he and I met, was I really got a certain aspect of something that was there. He was also drawing really equally from all different kinds of dance forms, ballet and contemporary dance, which were not coming together yet in the world that I had encountered. It was either you train in contemporary dance or you train in ballet. And he was using idioms from both of those languages. Also, he was using a lot of social dance elements because he put himself through the Juilliard School as a go-go dancer at Trudy Heller's,
wow,
which was a big nightclub in New York City. So he was a really, really good dancer.
I never knew that about him.
And he also had like folk dance feelings in his body, like, so he was drawing from all these different forms and making this work that was just making a lot of people uncomfortable. Like, don't put ballet steps and contractions in the same choreography, or
again, breaking down that codification,
yes,
right?
And he had like a huge range of physicalities. Like, you know, when that company only had 10 members, like there was a woman who was Japanese, 5 feet tall, and like a huge blonde guy, 6'3", and then the rest of us are all like somewhere in the midst of all that, it was a really unusual looking company at the time. And then later, so for me, the company of Bill T. Jones or Mark Morris, these companies, Laura was the first person who said, mm-hmm. I love this person's dancing. You don't mistake them for anybody else. And you couldn't really say, oh, this person's a Lubovitch dancer, because he chose really unique individuals. And this was a world that I saw when I saw his work, and this was a world that I wanted to be part of.
It's fascinating. And really, when I think about your trajectory from there, not your solo career perhaps, but your group career, working with people mm-hmm. like Baryshnikov, working with people like Mark Morris, that tendency kind of continued in some ways, didn't it?
Yes.
Because the projects you did with Baryshnikov through White Oak also had very individual dance talents within them. It didn't feel like a homogenous look.
Right.
So you're sort of allowing us to understand that influence really came from
and
that
in
experience.
And in fact, in that White Oak company where there were 8 dancers, 3 of us were from Lars' company.
Interesting.
So that was, and Mark Morris was in Lars' company. He had been in Lars' company and he left by the time I got there. And then he came back and did a tour of Southeast Asia with us, a 9-week tour where we were in a different country every week.
Oh my gosh.
And it was incredible to be with Mark on that tour. And he was buying cassette tapes. This was the state of the art at that time. Everywhere we went, and he brought back a treasure trove of music that I saw him keep dipping into that over many, many years. I mean, very often it was played live, but.
So you're on the road with these incredible people performing incredible roles. You've got to write your autobiography or something, woman. Like, you know, we could spend just an hour just talking about all those different touring experiences.
Yeah, we've only gotten to 1990 in our conversation so far.
Can you just tell me one touring story that might stand out? And then we will skip ahead to the next phases, I promise.
Oh, my goodness. I don't know if I can just tell you one, but I just will say that one of the things that really was being in these theaters in Europe where there's just so much history. Like, you'd be backstage and you were just like, oh, for example, in Berlin, we danced at the theater for the Berliner Ensemble. Mm-hmm. And I'm just thinking, Kurt Weill was back here.
Yeah.
And my teacher, Catherine Sergava, from the Herbert Berghoff Studio in New York City, was a dancer, and you know, who also was an actor in that work. Or being backstage at the old Sadler's Wells, like, I just was thinking, who had their hand on this bar? Who sat in front of this mirror? Like, it was just incredible to feel like you're part of this really long history. I just loved being in those buildings.
So, Peggy, you took a right turn in some ways after that, didn't you? Or a left turn, one would say, when you made a transition back to, or not back, but you made a transition forward to
this idea
of becoming a solo performer.
Mm, this was really inspired by Baryshnikov, because the year that I spent in White Oak, I saw this person. He had just stepped down as artistic director of American Ballet Theater, Of course, he was part of the artistic direction, but we did not feel that in the company. What we felt was we were dancing with him, because he wasn't choreographing the work. Mark Morris choreographed everything that first year. But I just saw somebody who was taking charge of his creative life, and he was only a few years older than me. And I just said to myself, I have so much respect for what he's doing. And if I would stop and ask myself, because I was 38, I think, and at the time you were kind of expecting maybe you'd get to dance a bit in your 40s. It was sort of before we really understood how much room there could be choreographically mm-hmm. and performatively. And I just asked myself, there's just so many things that I'm still curious about and that I want to do. And what would happen if I walked into a studio alone and no one told me what I'm going to do now? And I just felt like you need to ask yourself this question. It was a it was a little bit of a hard decision to make, but I did feel at the time I need to find out or I'll always be wondering. So again, I wasn't like Dancemakers. I wasn't thinking I'm making a company. I'm going to have a solo career. I just said to myself, what do you, you know, left to your own devices, what will you do?
You don't sound like someone who has been afraid of these big decisions at any time in your life, which is why you're here 30 years later making these incredible works. So what that choice, I mean, I remember when you made that announcement and it was like, wow, you were going to be a solo performer and make your own work on your own body at first, pretty much. So what were those first steps like?
Well,
of course, you worked with other people, Paul Andre Forte and others.
Yes, but I was doing three different things. I was acquiring solos. The first work that I did with Paul Andre was a great, great work he had made for Susan McPherson. And I just said to myself, that is so far from anything I've ever done before. How could I walk into that space? So I was seeking out particular works that I really wanted to challenge myself with. I was commissioning choreographers to make work for me, and then I was just walking into a room by myself.
Who did you commission at that time?
Annabelle Gamson.
Okay.
And Doug Varone. Okay. Actually were the first people. I'm saying commission, it sounds so grandiose. I asked them, would you make a work for me?
That's a commission.
I can
pay you 5 cents, but
yeah, well really. I mean, I was offering them a little bit of money because it was before a grant. It was before anything. I was just trying to see what I could do.
Was the importance of live music on stage and in collaboration already important to you?
Yes.
Because that's a very defining part of your work as a choreographer.
Here's the thing. Honestly, that was the outcome of a gift from Mark Morris. Because when I danced with White Oak, I shared two parts with Misha. One of them I never danced. But the other, we did a lot of swapping back and forth, and it was a work called 10 Suggestions that Mark Morris had made for himself. I saw him perform it the weekend that I moved to New York City in December 1980. That weekend, I went and saw a concert, and Mark Morris danced 10 Suggestions. And I went home, and I wrote a poem about it. And then he wanted Misha and I both to learn this dance. So when I left White Oak, he gave it to me as a gift. And I mean, that is
amazing.
And I'd only ever danced it with live music. And he did not make that a condition at all. But I just said to myself, I'm going to find a musician to perform this with. And music had always been really I'm going to sound really old now. My first husband, Mikhail Baryshnikov, whose name I carry to this day. And I were married when we were in our 20s, and he was a musician and a composer, eventually a composer. And so I always had music in my home because he was playing and he was creating. And it felt very immediate, natural for me to be working with live music. And honestly, it's something that I really missed with Laura. We hardly ever performed with live music. Mm-hmm. We did a little bit with Steve Reich Ensemble and a couple of other really incredible opportunities. But I asked some friends I hadn't lived in Toronto for 10 years, and I asked Mikhail Baryshnikov and Henry Kucharczyk if they could recommend a pianist for me. And they both recommended the same person, and it was this man named Andrew Barashko. He was 23 years old, I think, so he's a young man. And so we got together, and on the very first day that we worked together, he arrived with his music in a briefcase, and he took out a metronome, and he put it on the piano, and he asked me what the metronome timing was, and I said, well, we're not going to work with that at all. I'm going to listen to you play, and then we're going to talk about the music, and then I'll show you the dance, but without any music, and then we'll start working together, and we loved working together, and so the next thing I thought of some piano music, and then it kind of went from there. I just realized this is very special, and I'm going to pursue this.
You also worked for a very long time with Ahmed Hassan as a musician and a collaborator.
Yeah.
Can we talk about Ahmed for a few minutes?
Yeah, I'd love to talk about Ahmed.
Yeah. He was a huge influence in so many people's lives.
Yes. Yeah, well, I met Ahmed in the late 70s, maybe, for sure, by the early 80s.
You met in Winnipeg, is that right?
No. Oh. We met in Toronto.
Okay.
We met in New York City. He's someone I knew just from the dance world because he played for a lot of classes.
And he was a member of EDM in Vancouver. He was one of the founding members of
EDM. Describes himself as the M in EDM. Experimental dance and music. He was the one musician in that gang. So I was crossing paths with him lots, and he played for my classes quite often. I kind of knew him, and he lived in New York City for a while because he also had an American. He was born in the U.S., actually. Of Egyptian parents, so he had an Egyptian passport, and then they all moved to Canada, I think in 67 or 69, 1969. So he was a citizen of the world, but we fell in love in Winnipeg.
You know why I say Winnipeg? Because I remember him walking into my office at the Dance Umbrella of Ontario soon after he came home from Winnipeg.
Okay.
And saying to me, "You're not going to believe this. I am the luckiest person in the whole world. Peggy Baker loves me." And I remember that. Like it was yesterday. Aww. And I was like, wow, you are very lucky. Aww. And so is she.
Well, we did fall in love.
Yes.
Yeah, yes.
Fantastic. And you made some beautiful works together.
Yeah.
Really special.
Yeah. Yeah, it was a really special time in my life. So through my entire solo career, that full 20 years, this was my time with Ahmed. And we just made two different pieces together, really, and they were early on. Because he did not play for that much longer after we got married. He had primary progressive MS. And within maybe 6 years, he had lost the use of his hand, so he was not playing music anymore. But yeah, his whole approach to everything had a really, really big impact on me. I think I danced for so long because of Ahmed and because of that example of you don't need to be perfect. Everything doesn't need to be all perfectly in place to be able to engage mm-hmm. with your art form and with the world around you. So yes, I still had a lot of music in my home, and he was learning a lot of classical Arabic singing by the time he couldn't play anymore. And he was doing that mainly for pleasure, but there were music lessons happening in my home mm-hmm. with this mm-hmm. beautiful classical Arabic music.
And, fantastic. Mm-hmm. So this idea of collaboration and working with artists, we're going to jump ahead to some degree. And as I say, we could talk for hours and hours about all these incredible influences, but this is very present in the work that you've now made. You make a leap from smaller ensembles to a larger ensemble of dancers in this huge collaboration with Sarah Neufeld and Jeremy Gara.
Right.
So, I mean, it's not a surprise to someone like me who follows your career to see this incredible association with music, but what is this about, the sort of idea that dance partners with other art forms, this thing we call multidisciplinary or cross-disciplinary work that is so compelling to you as a creator?
Well, it's the collaborative. It's just about collaboration. And it's also about viewing performance as a creative act. One of the things that really allows dance to stay absolutely immediate is if the music is live, because then it's a rapport with another person who's in the throes of the creative act with you. And so for me, I just always loved it more. And I also very early on realized that the presence of the musicians on stage set a bar for me that had to do with authenticity as my authentic physical language. Because otherwise I was going to look ridiculous on stage with someone who was not concerned with how they looked. Everything had to do with creating the music, and they're using their bodies for that. Mm-hmm. And of course their emotions and their intellect, but physically it's all an application to the music. And I wanted to see if I could approach dance the same way, so that I was not trying to fix it up I was really wanting to engage on it on a very primary, or with it on a very primary level. And so this just became more and more of an imperative for me. And honestly, this new piece really arose out of an invitation. I thought I was completely done my performing. I did my final solo concert, where, in other words, where I danced the show from beginning to end in 2008. I didn't know before I went on stage. It was my last one, but I know when I came off, I said, I won't be doing that again.
Really?
Yeah. I realized, oh, you just hit a certain kind of a threshold, and it's just a little too... It's too tenuous now. Mm-hmm. So at first I started, putting other things on my program so I wasn't dancing the whole thing. Anyway.
And then also giving over time, creating a choreographer's trust and giving your work to other people so that the work would live on in particular ways.
Right. But then in 2015, so I did my last solo concert in 2008. Then I was still doing things for a few years there. Then Ahmed died in 2011, and that really... That was a very jarring time, even in my creative life. I really lost my bearings. So then by 2015, I was invited to do a solo for Fall for Dance North, which was this brand new festival in Toronto. And I said to them, I don't dance anymore. Maybe you haven't heard, but... And they were like, well, yeah, well, we think we really, really want you to do a solo on opening night. Honestly, I said no to them, I think, three times. Thank goodness Ilter just kept coming back to me. So finally, and Meredith, my manager, was saying to me, you need to accept it. Because I said to them, I was giving them all kinds of, suggestions about things my dancers could do, my company could do. And then finally I realized, okay, you just have to accept this opportunity because it's a door. It's wide open. It's not a door you were expecting to open. But so then I just said to myself, what would you do at this moment to go back on stage? And I just said to myself, it has to be something completely new. I have to find a completely new person to work with. So I wanted to work with a woman. I wanted to work with a woman who was at least a generation younger than me, and I wanted to work with somebody from the rock world, because I said, I have not done that. Mm-hmm. And at first I was thinking electric guitar. Mm-hmm. And then I thought, maybe I can't quite do that. And then I thought about Sarah Neufeld, and I had encountered her music. There used to be a fantastic radio show on CBC called The Signal. Was Laurie Brown's show.
Late at night.
And she played incredible music. And I knew Sarah Neufeld's music from The Signal. And then there was somebody on the board of directors of Fall for Dance North who said, well, I've got a connection with Arcade Fire, and that's the band that Sarah Neufeld is in, and I'll get you her email address. So I sent her, out of the blue, an email saying, hi, you don't know me.
But
she accepted my invitation to do something together. I loved working with her so much. I just felt, sometimes you meet someone and you just go, oh, yes, I've just been waiting to cross paths with you. We had two performances in the morning of our second show. I took her out for coffee and I said, Sarah, it will break my heart if this is the only thing we ever do together. I would love to make a work for my company with you, a full evening work. And she said, yeah, I've been thinking the same thing.
And so Who We Are in the Dark was born.
Yes, it was.
Let's spend a few minutes talking about that. I'm so happy that NAC Dance was able to support the work, that it was one of the first projects supported by the National Arts Center New Creation Fund.
Oh, I know. It's just been one door opening after the other. It's just been unbelievable.
Well,
not only is it incredibly
well-deserved, and many presenters got on board to support the work, but also you were saying to us, this is a bigger, new vision for myself. I want an opportunity to, as we sometimes say, punch above my weight.
Yes.
And you've done that. So people will get a chance to see the work in, this mm-hmm. weekend in Ottawa and other places around the country. But how would you talk about the work now, several months into the creation and following the premiere of the work? What does it say to you? What do you want to say to people about it?
Well, this work is speaking the language of the body, first of all. from the musicians, because, and Sarah talks about music arising from her body. I love this description of hers. It's sort of a culmination of some really intimate relationships, creative relationships. Marc Perrin and I have been working together since my very first solo performance, which was Winnipeg in 1990.
As a lighting designer.
He's amazing. It's through him that I really discovered my aesthetic, because he's the person who showed me what my work could look like on stage.
Right.
And we sort of grew together as artists. He was very young as a lighting designer, and I was brand new as a choreographer. And so this has been an incredible and primary relationship in my creative life. Then I really, I've been building this group of dancers, building relationships with these very individual artists. And they span a wide range of sort of, I almost want to say, views about dance and why they dance and how they dance. So they're all very distinctive. It's very poetic. The work is extremely poetic. I think it's still, it's very, very visual. And I hope that all the visual elements help to deliver actually the audience to these very intimate scenes. Because for me, that's still absolutely the heart of the work. But I feel that the richness of all the visual elements on the stage help people understand what it is, like the context in that they're receiving the choreography within. I hope it takes them a little bit more inside of the dancers in a certain way. They're vocalizing, and it's sort of pre-verbal, pre-music, the vocalizing, and so it's a little shocking almost sometimes. The subject matter, I feel, is so, it was a little bit like me asking myself, like, what would you, you know, who are you when no one's telling you what to do? Like, who are we in the dark? Who do we discover ourselves to be at different moments in our life when big things happen? I don't know. Maybe when we become a mother, or when we lose our partner, or when we're no longer, you know, the frame of our life drops away, you know, when I'm no longer a dancer, or I really wanted to contemplate this in a more full kind of poetic world. So I hope that the audience will enter in to sort of complete the fragments of stories that emerge or reveal themselves. I hope they will complete them through the lens of their own life. It's not one specific story that tells itself from beginning to end, but absolutely there are entries and fragments of stories. I think there's basically three different pathways through this work. It could be like spending the afternoon going, you know, in a great art exhibition, because visually it's very, very rich and complex. Could be like listening to a concept album from beginning to end, or listening to an entire symphony. Or it could be like seeing a great dance performance, but you can enter it from any one of those pathways. And I just truly hope it literally speaks to people's bodies and to their hearts and to the stories in their own lives.
Peggy, we are so looking forward to having this piece here at NAC Dance, and I just can't tell you how important your contribution and your artistry has been to all of us in this country and well beyond. And thank you for this time. Thank you for spending time with me. And I plan to keep bringing your projects back here for years to come. So there you go.
Wonderful.
And we'll do it again soon. Okay. Thank you so much.
Thank you.